در عربستان سعودی چی میگذرد؟ آیا محمد بن سلمان ولیعهد عربستان در پی اصلاح بنیادی این جامعه به شدت سنتی است؟ اگر هم واقعا چنین قصدی دارد، آیا میتواند؟ موانع سر راهش کدامند و موانع از کجا و به چه شکل ممکن است بروز کند؟ چرا اصلاح جامعهش را در زمانی آغاز کرده که یک پایش در یمن گیر است و پای دیگرش در مقابله با ایران؟ آیا مذاکرات پشت پردهش با اسرائیل سبب نمی شود که اصلاحاتش تحت شعاع مخالفت های محتمل افکار عمومی عربستان و جامعه های عرب قرار بگیرد؟ برای جواب به این سوال ها جمال خشوقجی، روزنامه‌نگار برجسته عربستان سعودی و نزدیک به خاندان آل سعود، مهمان من در این برنامه است. او که خود از طرفداران اصلاحات در عربستان بوده، در حال حاضر در واشنگتن در تبعید است. Mr. Jamal Khashoggi, welcome to the program.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. You have always supported reform in Saudi Arabia, and for that matter, you have been exiled. And yet, you're not happy with the way that the Mohammed bin Salman is carrying out his reform. Why?
Yes, I have always supported reform. In fact, I called for women driving. I called for unplugging support for radicalism, curb on to fight corruption. I even lost my jobs as an editor of a newspaper twice because of that. And Mohammed bin Salman is doing exactly those things which we truly need in Saudi Arabia. But on the same time, he's arresting intellectuals, arresting independent people who called for fighting corruption, and that what made me choose to exile myself here in Washington. Yes, we do need reform, but we need also consensus. We need also a rule by the people, not one-man rule, so we could be sure that we are doing the right thing. Basically, Mohammed bin Salman is doing the right things in Saudi Arabia the wrong way.
So if at the end of the day what he's doing is end up doing the reform, as you said, the kind of reform that you and people like yourself and perhaps the majority of the younger generation in Saudi Arabia want, doesn't matter if you get the result, but doesn't matter how he's going about it?
What is the result? The result should be the prosperity of Saudi Arabia, providing jobs for millions of Saudis. If he succeeds in doing that, I will be stand corrected and I will admit faults. And I will say I underestimated his power to drive Saudi Arabia into the future. But how can we succeed with a strong element of the Saudi society intimidated, arrested, and the plan is not being discussed? There is no discourse in Saudi Arabia, nor about the fight against corruption, nor about the fight against radicalism. We just receive instructions from the leadership, and we just have to follow it. This will not work.
Yeah, some believe, Mr. Khashoggi, that in a non-democratic society, a society which is basically the religious bigotry is rampant, perhaps the only way to carry out reform is with this kind of methods, which is non-democratic, autocratic even. But at the end of the day, the reform might be possible. You cannot, in a society which is not democratic, go about and asking people, how do you want to carry out your reform? That's some people are that kind of opinion. Why do you think they're wrong?
Yes, Saudi Arabia was never seen as a democratic society, but on the same time, they were not an environment of intimidation and arresting of people for no good reason. This is what is new. This is what made many people suspicious of the reform plan and worry. Again, I wish Mohammed bin Salman all the success he needs, because his success is the success for my country and the success for my children and my grandchildren. But how can he achieve that success without involving more people around him? We should always remember that one-man rule have failed in a number of countries. I don't have to mention them, but it had been proven throughout the history. And I don't want the same result happened in Saudi Arabia, the same consequences happened in Saudi Arabia. It had been proven. One-man rule always fail.
You said that people become suspicious, and like yourself. So when you say that, does that mean that he is not genuinely after reform? He had other thing in mind?
I don't know. He could be genuinely for reform, because they will. Let's talk about corruption, for example. There is no way his ambitious plan 2030 to succeed without verge on corruption. Corruption is killing Saudi Arabia. It is depleting the Saudi wealth, corrupting the people, not only the merchants and the royals. Even the people will get corrupted if you allow corruption to spread. And there is no way any economic transformation to succeed without fighting corruption. He promising us to fight corruption, and honestly, he is. He is doing that right now. He is going after royals, after merchants. But again, it's not transparent. We would like to know more information. We would like to know what kind of deals are happening and why a number of other royals who are very much involved in corruptions were not called to be investigated. Why a number of business people who are also active in corruption haven't been called. Someone could argue with me and say, they will be called later. All right, we will wait. But again, what we are seeing is a campaign for reform that it is being conducted from the top down, from the center to the parameters. We, the people of Saudi Arabia, have no choice but to watch, some of us in fear, some of us in celebration. There are many Saudis who are welcoming this and celebrating that. I am here from my vantage point in Washington. I'm monitoring that, and I have the freedom to speak out. And probably I speak on behalf of many Saudis who cannot speak. I'm not against what he's doing, but I just want to be a second opinion.
You're right. Okay, let's assume that his reform is genuine and he really wants to change the Saudi Arabian society and modernize it. What would be his main challenges?
I think his main challenges should be economics. He needs to provide jobs to the people. This is the biggest problem he should see in Saudi Arabia. We have at least from 3 to 4 million Saudis who are unemployed or employed but who do not have decent jobs. The Saudi economy or the Saudi workforce is very much controlled, and the economy is very much controlled by foreign labor. Foreign labor do not only own the jobs, they also own the businesses, the small and medium business in Saudi Arabia. 70% of the workforce in Saudi Arabia are foreign. This where his fight should be, to free the Saudi labor market from the occupation of foreign labor and the ownership of foreign labor, and bring back the ethics of work to Saudi Arabia. That is his most serious challenge. If there will be, in 4 or 5 years, a administration in Saudi Arabia, it will not be over a religious issue. It will not be over a political issue. Most probably, it will be over economic issue. People without a political agenda who need jobs will come out on the street demanding their rights for a better life.
But you say that is not over the religious issues. But how can it be? Because Saudi Arabia is a very conservative society, and the Wahhabism is very rampant. And they obviously they're not going to be in favor of Saudi Arabian society opening up and becoming like a Western country, like freedom for the women and all other things that perhaps the Prince Mohammed bin Salman is after. They obviously look, they may oppose it. Yeah.
I think people in Saudi Arabia probably grow tired of radicalism. The Wahhabism that was in the, that was forced on the people of Saudi Arabia made them have second thoughts about religion and the rule of religion altogether. They are good Muslims. They want to be good Muslims, but they don't want to be radical Muslims who follow a very narrow-minded past. Religion is a choice, whether we are talking about Saudi Arabia or Iran or in Turkey. I think when you have the choice, you could become more religious. And it had been proven that a year ago, the religious police was kind of disarmed totally in Saudi Arabia, and the people did not care. In fact, the people celebrated the disappearance of the mutawwi'een, as we call them. So we should not really put so much weight on religious sentiments or the radical sentiments, whether Wahhabism or not. Saudi Arabia will always be a Muslim country, and people in Saudi Arabia will always be somehow religious, but people will not stand or get angry because of the disappearance of the mutawwi'een or the religious police. They want to enjoy life and they want to have more money in their pockets. That's what the matter, and this is the true challenge that's going to face Mohammed bin Salman, is to make his people happy.
So you don't anticipate any some sort of opposition from the religious sector in Arabian society, any serious one at least?
No, not at all. Okay. Actually, when we talk about radicalism in Saudi Arabia, radicalism was allowed and tolerated and plugged in by the government. And when Mohammed bin Salman unplugged the government support to Wahhabism and radicalism, it all fall apart. It is not a popular movement. It is not like a political Islam popular movement who grew from the people. It is government-sponsored movement. So when the government unplug it, it fall apart.
Okay, so there are those who believe that the Mohammed bin Sultan is not really after a genuine reform in Saudi Arabia, and because his reform is pick and choose, there are here and there, there are very, very light kind of reforms, like, for example, a woman being able to drive or go to these sporting stadiums and that kind of thing. But the main purpose is to please his Western allies, as particularly the Americans, in order to support him in his other ambitions in the region, especially confronting the Iran.
No, I totally disagree with that. Any wise man in Saudi Arabia knows those issues need to be dealt with and finished in Saudi Arabia. And we should give him the credit for reform, genuine reform. He, as a young man, he grew up in a rigid Saudi Arabia, and I'm sure he did not like the way his country and is. And so we should give him the benefit of the doubt. That true reform is are needed. And to me, as a citizen of Saudi Arabia, I am willing to support those reforms because he is removing those unnecessarily packages we had with us, like the woman driving issue, like the cinemas, like the theater and the music. They are being dealt with and finished and removed out of the way so we can address serious true issues like employment, like people participation, democracy, better judiciary, better life altogether. So As a citizen, I want to give him the benefit of the doubt and support his reform, because he's serving me and serving my attention as a reformer Saudi by removing those unnecessary issues, such as women driving. For example, now you are not going to ask me about women driving because we have dealt with it. It is behind us now. And maybe if you interview Mohammed bin Salman, you will ask him about democracy, not about women driving.
Mm-hmm. Right. OK. So, I mean, he is going through this reform at a time when he is heavily involved in Yemen. As you know, the Mohammed bin Salman and Saudi Arabian generally is blamed for worldwide, blamed for heavy casualties in Yemen, many of them civilians, by bombings the yes. Yemeni cities. Many believe that the Yemen has become a quagmire for the Saudi Arabia. And it looks like unwinnable war that he's engaged. At that time, when he is heavily engaged there, on the other hand, he is engaged with confronting Iran in the region as well. So do you think it's a right time to go through reform as well, while he is involved with all these events?
I think, yes, it is the right time. He should go to reform, and he should spend more time in Saudi Arabia. But at the same time, we, the Saudi people, we held him responsible and our government responsible to protect us from Iranian expansionism. Iranian expansionism is a true threat to Saudi Arabia, to Saudi Arabia as a state or to us as a people. We are unhappy to see Iranians changing demography, changing history in the north of Saudi Arabia, and sending thousands of militias to fight our brothers in Syria and change the status quo in Yemen. This is something to worry about. And we also, the Saudis, need to be honest and frank with Mohammed bin Salman and tell him that his mistakes are what allowing the Iranians to continue in their expansionism. And he need to develop better strategy to counter Iran. He need to create a better plan by consolidating the Sunni of the Muslim world around him, not to alienate the Sunnis around him. He is in forcing Saudi Arabia into a confrontation with the Gulf state, like the small state of Qatar, with the political Islam, which is a fighting force that could counter the Iranians' expansionism, with Turkey, which is another natural ally to Saudi Arabia. So he needs to develop a better strategy to counter the Iranians.
Yeah, but the Iranian could say exactly the same thing against Saudi Arabia for the expansionism, for the involvement in Yemen, for involvement in Lebanon. I mean, what happened with Mr. Hariri, it was a big example of how to what extent the Saudi Arabia is actually interfering in the internal affairs of Lebanon. If Iranian supporting Hezbollah, then we have Rafiq Hariri and the way that the Saudi Arabia is treating them. These are the kind of argument that the Iranian would put forward.
Yes. I know the Iranians put this argument, but we should remember that when we are talking about Lebanon and Syria and Yemen, they are all part of the Saudi Arabian horizons, or what is the term in English to describe? It is the national interest of Saudi Arabia to be there since the 60s. It is the Iranians who are the new force who came in to those areas, and Saudi Arabia doesn't have an expansionist policy there. Actually, Saudi Arabia don't have a strategic policy. It is on the defensive. The Iranians are on the attack. We are on the defensive. So Saudi Arabia should not be compared to Iran. And I wish we had a strategic plan as the Iranians do, but unfortunately, we don't.
Yeah. But mind you, I mean, Iranian always argued that they were invited by the Syrian government, the legitimate Syrian government, to get involved in the Syrian situation. But with Saudi Arabia,
I know it, but it's a dictatorship. It is a dictatorship. It is a shame for the Iranian to support.
But Saudi Arabia is a dictatorship as well. You see, that's the thing. They're all a bunch of dictatorships, basically fighting each other.
Yeah. But what that got to do with the Syrian dictatorship? There is no revolution in Saudi Arabia, and there are no Iranians fighting in Saudi Arabia. But the Iranians are fighting in Syria in support of a dictatorship.
Mm-hmm. Well, recently, when there was a missile was fired towards Saudi Arabia from Yemen, the Saudi officials basically declared that this is a war against Saudi Arabia by Iran. So, with this kind of talking and the tension that exists, do you envisage that there's going to be a war between Iran and Saudi Arabia?
I don't think so, because both countries know the heavy cost of such a war. I don't think there will be a war between both countries, but this confrontation, they will continue. Saudi Arabia is quite confused in Syria. It is beginning to read the Yemeni situation better. I think the best way for Saudi Arabia to in Yemen is to push for some form of reconciliation that will involve all Yemenis on a power-sharing formula that include the Houthi, the Islah, and everybody else. One of the reasons why the war was prolonged in Yemen because Saudi Arabia had a very difficult condition to succeed, that the defeat of the Houthi should not benefit the Islah, which the Muslim Brotherhood of Yemen. And it looked like Mohammed bin Salman began to reconsider this policy. He met a few days ago with the leader of al-Islah, and I hope that will be a beginning of some new strategy that will lead to a power-sharing formula in Yemen that could bring peace. And that's and here where probably the Iranians can start negotiating, even behind closed doors or through European friends, to come up with a formula that will end the misery of the Yemenis altogether.
But the Iranians, as you know, many times they mentioned that they are willing to talk to Saudi Arabia and improve their relations.
Of course, the Iranians always say that, but at the same time, they want to continue their infringement, their involvement, their militias, their killing in Syria and in Yemen. The Iranians are good at that. Let's talk and let me do what I want to do around you.
All right. Okay, let's turn to Israel. I mean, recently, the Israeli energy minister revealed that the Saudi Arabia and Israel have been talking to each other. It looks like they have, behind the scene, they have a very good relations. And they've been talking about Iran as well most of the time. This is now in the open. And do you think this is going to go down with the Arab opinion, the public opinion, well, to Saudi Arabia to align himself with Israel and against another Muslim country?
Not at all. It will hurt Saudi Arabia if Saudi Arabia indulge in such a thing. But Saudi Arabia have denied all allegation that it is talking to the Israelis, and I want to stick to this denial. It is not right for Saudi Arabia to do so. It is the land of the two holy mosques, the land of the Haramain, and the Muslim world look to it for as an example state that will never reconcile with the Israeli occupation, and we the Saudis must maintain that. And probably if there were such talks in the past, I think they were all overblown by the Trump decision. So whoever thought that we in Saudi Arabia or the leadership in Saudi Arabia can be able to enforce some kind of a grand deal on the Palestinians, he should think twice, because the Palestinians people are the one who will decide And they will have the final say. So my advice to my government is totally to pull out and go back to the Saudi principle of that was laid down by King Abdullah in 2001. No reconciliation, normalization with Israel until the Israeli withdraw from 1967 border. Yeah. That is the best for Saudi Arabia. And the other thing I would that if we the Saudi think that Donald Trump and Jared Kushner can deliver to us any deal, we are wrong. They cannot. Basically, they cannot, and it had been proven.
Mr. Khashoggi, it seems that the Saudi leader, especially the Mohammed bin Salman, is very much his opinion is completely different. He thinks that they actually, by siding with the Israelis, they can bring the kind of peace that is favored, probably as the. It recently was suggested the kind of proposal that the Saudi Arabia put forward. It's just it's favored Israel rather than the Palestinians. And recently, last week, basically, when there was a summit meeting by the Islamic countries, many of the prominent in Islamic countries, they send their leaders there, except the Saudi Arabia, who send an advisor to the foreign ministry. It seems that they are not taking it very seriously. People can interpret that this is not siding with the Palestinians, but with the Israelis.
That was very unfortunate of Saudi Arabia not to send a higher delegation. We should remember that the OIC was started as a call by King Faisal. So it was very unfortunate, but we should not see it as it is a snub to the Palestinians and more toward the Israelis. No, maybe it was a snub toward Turkey. You see, the Saudi foreign policy is quite confused. It has this apprehension, doubts about political Islam, about Turkey, who are its natural allies. And it is very much doubtful and trustful of them, and it needs to reconsider that position. But I'm sure Saudi Arabia will know, or the leadership will know, that they cannot dictate to the Palestinian people any future deal. The one who will decide the future of Palestine are the Palestinians under occupation, not the Saudis, not the Iranians, not anyone else.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jamal Khashoggi. Thank you for talking to us.
Thank you.